Hello everyone, it's the Man of Yorke here, and it's been a long time no see. So today I've got a video ready for you, finally, all about churches, and it's going to be a church crawl with none other than Rob Andrews, a really fantastic content creator on Instagram and YouTube, who is an expert in church furnishings, church architecture, everything churches. He knows pretty much everything you could know about churches from the Middle Ages upwards, so he's a great companion to have with me. So it was a real pleasure to spend time with Rob back in, it was before Christmas when we did this little walk, and essentially we toured around four Norman churches which had these amazing Norman fonts in them, and they're really wacky and strange, and so I'll do an introduction about them and then we'll continue with the crawl. So I really hope you enjoy the video. I really enjoyed filming it, and it was fantastic having Rob there with his knowledge and also his passion for the subject.
The font was a key agent in the sacraments of the church, and undoubtedly one of the most important pieces of church furniture, as these basins of stone were used to initiate newborn Christians into the local congregation. This meant that in the Middle Ages, these utilitarian objects were filled with mysticism. Four churches in the East Riding are very special, as they still host ancient artisanal fonts which are possibly 800 years old. The East Riding fonts represent a school of stone carving which could in some respects be regarded as naive in style, depicting crudely carved figures and a mishmash of folk styles.
Most early scholars of church furnishings saw the fonts as kind of crude and primitive almost in their style, but they are actually really interesting because they're so didactic. They've got lots of beautiful imagery from the Bible and from allegories from the time and from philosophy, and so although they were probably carved by a school of craftsmen who were unused to these kind of objects and scenes, they were probably directed by quite educated clergymen, possibly Augustinian monks living in Yorkshire.
There were once six Norman fonts in this part of Yorkshire, but one is now in Hull Museum and the other is lost in America. In this video, Rob and I are going to attempt to find the last remaining Norman fonts still to be found in situ in the medieval churches of East Yorkshire. We will travel to Cowlam, Langtoft, Kirkburn and finish at North Grimston.
Everyone, it's Martin here, the Man of Yorke, and I'm joined by Rob.
How you doing?
And so today we're on like a church crawl around some amazing churches in East Yorkshire, and we started here at Cowlam to look at this amazing Norman font, and so we'll have a look at it.
This is it. Part of a series of East Riding fonts of this type, related to Augustinian canons in the area. And if we go around, you might have to help me, Martin, with some of the identification of bits of it. But I think here we've got the Magi coming to Christ, giving gifts. And here is one king with a fantastic censer.
So he's got his cool mitre on his head, hasn't he?
Yeah, it's amazing. I was saying as well, I love the architectural surrounds to them as well. And coming around here, you identified this chap. I don't know who it was, but it's King Harry, isn't it?
Yeah.
And he's
got his nasty henchmen with his sword ready to sort of kill the innocent firstborns.
Yeah. And coming round here, there's Adam and Eve, and the great serpent there climbing up a tree, which is one of the most, one of the busiest sort of bits, isn't it, as well?
They liked their foliage to the Normans, didn't they?
Yeah, they did.
And then we weren't so sure about this one, but I'm thinking maybe it might be Jacob like wrestling the angel, but then there's no sort of distinction between the two of them. Like, they both look exactly the same, don't they?
So, it's a difficult one. So, and then perhaps a sort of bishop here, but again, it's quite difficult to identify. But yeah, what an amazing font.
It's pretty cool, isn't it?
It's amazing.
And we've got loads more to find.
I think we're going to see some other fonts in this sort of series, local series as well, all produced of the same sort of era and same school workshop. So, yeah, I think we're going to go and see a few more, which would be amazing.
Yeah. Right, so we'll get going.
So I've picked a right weekend for this to come and visit in Yorkshire, because it's Storm Arwen at the moment. So we're absolutely frozen. That's what I would imagine as, yeah, pretty Baltic at the moment. but we're going to try to make it to all the churches and see how we go. Yep. So we've made it to the little church in Langtoft, and we almost didn't get in because it was locked up, and a chap told us that you could get the key maybe from a community centre, and so a lady kindly like let us in, and so we're having a good explore now. And as you can see, the church, it's got quite a good interpretation, so it's got lots of exhibits from the local history, and me being a medievalist, I was immediately drawn to this cool cross slab here, and as you can see, it's got shears, and shears are normally representations of this being a female burial. It says on it, Alina de Vale. So that'd be 13th century.
So a lot of the stained glass windows in this church at Langtoft are by Kemp glass, and you can tell because in all of these windows you can see the little signature in the bottom, and here we can see this one is a little black tower, which means that it's slightly later Kemp Studios glass, actually after Charles Emer Kemp died and it was taken over by his sons, and it was the whole studio was disbanded in the 1930s during the Great Depression, but this is a little signifier that we can tell it's slightly later Kemp glass, early 20th century. And the church is full of it. And it's actually really nice.
Which you said, Robert, was moved from this little chapel in Cotton, was
Cotton
it?
Cotton Chapel.
So that's the original kind of medieval church, and this got moved over to here when that was disused. But on this one, I think you can see, and this might be a representation of the Tree of Jesse, maybe? Or maybe the True Vine. It looks like quite an elaborate bit of foliage. And then over here, you've got Adam and Eve again. This time they've got kind of quite liberal covering for them this time, so they've got big palm leaves of some kind. And then this one has got some quite elaborate imagery of martyrdom on here. You've got St. Andrew being crucified on St. Andrew's kind of style cross, like a proper X cross. Got some beasts, a bird of some kind. And then the best bit, in my opinion, you've got St. Lawrence being cooked on a griddle there, and then of course the Hellmouth devouring the sinners. It's a pretty awesome font. There we go.
So this is Kirkburn, St Mary's Church at Kirkburn, and we've come to see the great font. And Martin's going to show you that in a bit. But this church is one of the biggest Norman churches in the East Riding in this part of the county. But I want to show you the amazing chancel arch and the screen. So the screen was installed in 1872 after what is described in the guidebook as a rather barbarous attempt at restoring the chancel, but I think it's quite endearing. But the screen itself is just amazing. It's by G. Street, painted by somebody else, but it's one of the most opulent sort of reflections of the kind of church fitting that would have been here in the Victorian times, and sort of in the style that you can still see in some parts of East Anglia. But the detail on it is just incredible stuff.
Font in Kirkburn Church, and you can see that it's got all kinds of amazing symbols on it. It's showing a baptism scene, which is very kind of relevant with the fact that this is a font. So here's a kid actually dunked in the font. He's just there, he's getting the chrism put on his head, and you'll see other strange symbols. Oh, a thing that Robert mentioned, which I thought was quite cool, was this chain, the way you've got this design over the top rim and how it changes, how it seems that as you go around it, you've got these kind of interesting architectural bits, but then they change into rings and what to me looks like a buckle design almost, and then this absolutely lovely kind of arches intertwining here, and then goes on to knotwork on the top as well. And we were wondering whether maybe you had two different craftsmen doing the same project, and so they're all putting in their own different little bits. You can also see down here the what they call the cat from hell. So that's a symbol of a cat devouring a mouse, so it's good devouring evil. You've got a coiled serpent, which is possibly the serpent of Eden, but it could also be a metaphor for evil or poison striking at any moment in medieval society. And also, I like this interesting symbol here, which we will say is the seal of Solomon, which is these entwined kind of ovals, which are supposed to be a symbol of wisdom. And then over here, which we particularly like, is you have Christ ascending, and so he's there with these guys pulling out the Rob, is it an aureole, the halo kind of thing that
yes.
will go around a saint? So they're pulling that out to kind of frame him. And then underneath you've got the representation of the Lamb of God. So, and he's going to a slaughter, and there's this particularly hideous guy at a club who's coming to slaughter the Lamb of God, because obviously Christ is being sacrificed for our sins. And he's also tethered to a beast, like a wolf of some kind or a dog. And apparently that's to represent how man is chained to his bestial nature. So at the final church in our journey, North Grimston. So we're going to have a look at the font, and then going to drop in at my favourite pub in Yorkshire, the Middleton Arms.
This is your favourite one then, Rob?
This is my favourite, yeah. It's the one I've not seen so far, so now I think that I've seen all of the fonts in this series. But this is by far my favourite one. I just can't believe it. Because of the Last Supper that wraps around at least 50% of the side of the tub.
Mm.
And stylistically, I just want to talk about this for a bit, because it's just incredible. It reminds me of scenes that you see on... even earlier, sort of like cross shaft art, pre-conquest other stonework, but all the items on the table, the elongated bodies that Martin helped point out, which I thought were really funny. But some of these, I don't know if it's hair or some of the bits around the head remind me of some similar style stonework at Nunburnham, which is near Pocklington.
Yeah, I know what you mean. The Scandinavian, what we call the Scandinavian slab, yes.
Anglo-Scandinavian sort of stuff.
And I don't know whether they're supposed to be hairstyles or halos or aureoles or whatever.
It's not quite clear, is it? But
and it's the same with Nunburnham, isn't it? Because people tried to claim that was a Viking hairdo, didn't they?
Yeah. And the ones at Nunburnham have bits that sort of flick out at the sides. Which again sort of adds to the confusion about it, but these ones it's almost like just sort of half a band room. And then Jesus in the middle as well, which is just one of the balmiest representations of Jesus that I think I've ever seen. It's almost like a bird perched on a little like a budgerigard on a little hook there, but the nimbus up there, the eyes, everything about it is just fantastic. It carries on around with the remaining cast of figures. And then, Martin, what were you saying about the other figures around this side, which is a reflection of more contemporary religion at the time?
So I was kind of thinking that maybe you've got a contemporary priest here, and so it's sort of comparing the Eucharist throughout the ages. So you've got the Last Supper, and then you're coming then into the present day, basically the Norman period, and they're still celebrating the Eucharist. So it's going full circle round. That's what I was thinking. Yeah. So yeah. And then of course you got the unusual depiction of Christ being taken down on Easter Saturday. So he's been taken down from the cross there, which is quite strange. So, yeah. So pretty good. Eh?
It's blown my mind completely. Yeah. It really has. Yeah. Fantastic.
So that was such a fun day back in December exploring churches with the church crawl himself, Rob Andrews. Such a great day, but also real chilly. It's a complete opposite today, because today is really muggy and hot and things, hot summer, and that day was really freezing. But it was a really great day for going church exploring, because we saw some amazing things. And I'd say the Yorkshire Wolds is still like one of my most favourite parts of the country, and even though I'm not living in York anymore, I do hanker after going up there to go and explore the beautiful historic churches, or go and look for the old Bronze Age burial mounds and other things like that. Oh gosh, I do love that part of the country. So Rob Andrews, of course, is such a passionate advocate for church exploring, and he's got a wealth of knowledge of church architecture and church furnishings and things. And if you're really interested in him as a content creator, he's got a brilliant YouTube channel which you can follow. I've got a link on the booking. I'll put a little link at the end. And his greatest thing is his Instagram channel, which is where he posts photos daily and reels exploring churches, and it's impeccably researched, all his content on Instagram. He's even also just released a zine as well, Under Steeple and Tower, which is a real good read. You can find them on Etsy. I think he's going to be releasing these periodically, and so they're like a little bulletin where he has academic articles all about church history, but also has travel diaries as well about his walks and going from church to church and finding interesting, surprising things in the countryside. And so if you're interested in those, look out for them on his shop on Etsy. So really good. So thank you again for joining me, Rob. That was a really great day out, and I hope everyone enjoyed the video of us nerding out talking about Norman fonts and things like that, and I hope you really enjoyed looking at these beautiful artifacts as much as I did. So thank you everyone for watching, and I'll catch you on the next one.